Buenos dias and good morning. Greetings and welcome as we gather. I feel blessed that we can be together as a church family to worship and to celebrate and to be in fellowship at a safe distance. For those in the sanctuary, welcome and greetings. We do ask that we do maintain our social distance, wear masks when we're in the sanctuary part, and that when we do speaking or singing, we do it softly. And just so you know, the offerings will go in these purple baskets or boxes. And you'll find in your bulletins these tan cards this week. If you would register your presence with us with your name, and if you're visiting with us, include a phone number as well, so that if we had to do social tracking, we would be able to get hold of you. For those, if there are anybody out in the parking lot, greetings and welcome. And to those who will be watching the video later, you missed a wonderful time of gathering together, but God is present with us all, and we're delighted that we can come together over on YouTube, Facebook, over the video. If you have any prayer requests, I would encourage you, you're welcome to write them on the tan cards, because we do, of course, look at those, and we will certainly be praying for you. With joy and gratitude, let us rejoice in God's blessings and that we can be together to worship. There's a meditation at the beginning of the bulletin to help us focus and come together.
Let us call ourselves to worship. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and gracious in all his deeds. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless his holy name forever and ever.
Thank you.
Let us continue our worship with prayer. Gracious Lord Jesus, in whose name we pray, thank you for this time when we can come before you and lift up the concerns of our lives. There is so much to say, and yet what we most want to hear is your voice and to experience your presence. Help us to know your love for us, calling us to live lives that reflect your truth and promises. By your grace, draw us nearer to you, for we so need your spirit, guidance, and power in our lives. We thank you, Lord God, for our church family, where we can be useful and where we can grow in our faith as we worship and serve in your name. Hear us, O Lord, as we pray as you taught your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. According to the book of 1 John, if we claim that we're not sinners, then we are self-deceived and strangers to the truth. But if we confess our sins, God is just and may be trusted to forgive our sins and cleanse us from every kind of wrong. Therefore, let us admit our sin using the prayer of confession and ask God to help us live more faithfully in the days ahead. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and we cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and left undone. We have not loved with our whole hearts, and we have not loved our neighbors as we should. In your great compassion, forgive our sins, renew us, help us, and lead us to live faithfully in the freedom you give us, so that we might delight in your will, walk in your ways, and serve you in newness of life in Jesus Christ. Amen. Having confessed our sin before God, who loves us and who saves us, let us walk anew. God calls us with a holy calling, not because of our good works, but because of God's own gracious love through Christ Jesus. Friends, believe the good news. All our sins are forgiven. By God's grace, we are loved and saved. Through the redeeming blood of Christ, our sin is forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. How can we live anew in trust and hope? In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed, and blessing the children, healing the sick, and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel.
Thank you. Good morning to all the young disciples. Here's hoping everyone can see me. Good morning, everybody. How many times have you ever had to say, "I'm sorry," to a friend or to a parent, maybe, that you've made angry or sad? I know I have. How many times have you wanted a friend or a parent to say they're sorry to you because they made you angry or sad? That's called forgiveness. When you say, "I'm sorry," and they say, "I accept your apology, that's okay," that is forgiveness. But something that people don't understand about forgiveness is isn't between you and the person you're forgiving. Forgiveness is between you and God. In your heart, you know when you want to forgive someone. When you're ready to forgive someone, you know. You and God know. And if you're not ready to forgive that person, then even if they say, "I'm sorry," and you say, "It's okay," they're not forgiven. It's okay not to want to forgive someone right away. When you're ready, it's the right time to forgive. And God knows that. Bow your heads and pray with me, please. Lord, I pray for these children. I pray for everyone here today. Whatever debts of forgiveness they may hold, I pray that in their own time, those debts will be resolved. In your name I pray, amen.
Let us pray together. Lord, we thank you for another day of life and blessing. Help us, we pray, to use it well. Help us in this time of worship to listen and keep our focus on you, on your word and promises. And please hear our lament as we cry out amid our troubles, our anxiety and fear, for the world around us feels so uncertain and disrupted. We pray for those who are struggling, caught up in the events of this world. Strengthen and protect those who are trying to make a positive difference, those fighting forest fires, those doing research on COVID-19, those protecting us from violence, and those who provide medical care and compassion. We pray for teachers and students, janitors and administrators who are trying to adjust, maintain, and accomplish education amid these very challenging circumstances. We pray that you'll grant them all a sense of your presence and hope, the assurance that we will get through this and that you are still sovereign, powerful, and at work healing and restoring your creation. We're grateful that for the most part, people are doing the best they can and trying to manage difficult, unfamiliar, and changing situations. Help us be a people of gentle patience and compassion. And may we reflect your own mercy and steadfast loving kindness. Lord, when we're feeling down and defeated, remind us of goodness and generosity, and that in the end, your wisdom, your healing, and your desire to save will prevail and conquer all forces of evil and destruction. We pray for our world, especially for the weak and powerless. We pray for our nation, that we will see each other as neighbors and not enemies or opponents that we need to crush. Lord Jesus, help us appreciate the wonderful diversity you infused into creation. And may we celebrate our differences that make us each one unique and special and gifted to enhance our life together in community. We pray that you'll be with those in need this day. And please guide our thoughts and compassion toward faithfulness and making a good difference. Help us by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit to walk and live in useful faithfulness and gentleness and patience and in awareness that many people are struggling and suffering. Lord, spoken words fail and fall short. Hear now our silent and private requests. We are grateful that now gathered in your name, you are with us, you hear us, and truly your compassion overflows. We pray this all through Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus, Lord, and liberty. The first scripture reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. Then Peter came to him and said, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, 'Pay what you owe.' Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you.' But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?' And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother and sister from your heart." The second reading is from the letter from Paul to the Colossians, chapter 3, verses 1 through 2, 12 through 17. "So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray together. Almighty, loving, and gracious God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable and pleasing in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. Amen. It's probably been quite a while since you've been in a movie theater, but can you recall a time when you were watching a movie and when a particularly despicable or abusive character finally gets what's coming to them, retribution, and the whole theater reacts with spontaneous applause. It can feel very satisfying and even gratifying when our perceived scale of justice is tipped back into balance, which may be our first response to this parable Jesus told. This parable is an answer to Peter's question about forgiveness, verse 21. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times. In the previous passage of Matthew 18 that we looked at last week, Jesus explained in a shepherd parable about leaving the 99 to look for the one, that it is not God's will or purpose that any should be lost. Therefore, the Lord never gives up on anyone, not ever, and so neither should we. According to Jewish understanding and tradition, you might forgive someone who sins against you three times, but not four. So Peter, recognizing how Jesus seems to perceive things, more than doubles the rabbinic teaching, suggesting seven times. Verse 22, Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you 77 times. That 77 times was a common idiom, meaning a larger number than you count. And according to life within the kingdom of God, faithful and obedient Christian forgiveness has no limit. We are to forgive beyond our ability to count or keep track. And in fact, if we are counting, then we really haven't forgiven, but waiting for them to exceed that boundary or limit. In this parable that Jesus tells, the numbers are way beyond reasonable. 10 talents was way more money than probably all of Palestine had, way more than a king would possess or certainly allow a slave to run up such a debt. And so the crowd may have even chuckled when Jesus said he owed that much. And when the slave said, have patience with me and I will pay you everything, they realized the impossibility of ever paying off such a debt. Verse 27, and out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave his debt. That was an incredible act of grace, forgiving all that this slave owned and was absolutely against all ways and expectations of this world. Let's consider how the plot of this parable has unfolded. The tension begins when the king demands an infinite payment. The slave cowers and begs, have patience with me and I'll pay everything. And then the king has pity, accepts the cost, this huge amount that's owed, and releases the debtor from prison, forgiving the whole debt, breaking with the normal ways that this world thinks and functions to demonstrate the gracious mercy of life in the kingdom of God. The point is, our sin against God is a debt we could never repay. But in Jesus Christ, God takes on our debt and freely forgives. Forgiveness is a gift of grace and a reflection of God's grace and mercy. We are saved by God's grace alone, which we accept by faith, but even that faith comes as a gift and mercy from God. Yes, our faithfulness and good deeds, they do matter, but not at all toward our salvation. In the next scene, starting verse 28, but that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. Seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me and I will pay you. But he refused, Then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. That debt of 100 denarii was a comparatively tiny amount. And notice that his fellow slave uses the same words, "Have patience with me and I will pay you." Jesus is emphasizing the contrasting size of these two debts. The obvious expectation is that this first slave, having received such grace and mercy from the king, that of course he will forgive that tiny debt as well out of gratitude for the massive debt that he's been forgiven. But rather than gratitude and sharing in this good fortune, the forgiven slave turns with surprising harshness, throwing his fellow slave, fellow debtor, into prison. Angry and shocked at the first slave's unjustified harshness, his fellow slaves report this unwarranted cruelty to the king, whose severe response gratifies our sense of fairness, that the scales of justice have been tipped back into balance. Verse 32, "Then his lord summoned him and said, 'You wicked slave, I forgave you of all the debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?'" It seems right that this nasty, greedy, harsh slave gets punished. And this parable matches our natural sense of balance and injustice as it demonstrates what we expect in this world to think and operate. And all is good until we get to verse 35, where it gets a little too personal. "So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart." If you isolate that one verse from the rest of the gospel, it is one of the most frightening and terrifying verses in the Bible, inferring that God forgives only to the degree that I have forgiven all who have ever harmed me, and that God forgives me only after I have forgiven others. But the truth is, God's forgiveness always comes first. And it's not conditioned upon our willingness to forgive. The point is that God's grace, God's power and excessive mercy can transform my attitude, even toward those who harm me or are unjust to me. And yet forgiveness when we've been betrayed or harmed doesn't come easy. In fact, it's really not something we can accomplish on our own, not entirely. Many years ago, I was in business with a very faithful Christian man, and we had an agreement that I was a full partner in the business. But after he died, his widow and her attorney plotted against me, deceived, betrayed, and cheated me in a major life-altering way, costing me that ownership and the money that I'd already earned, crushing the hopes and goals that I'd worked so hard to achieve. I felt devastated. The future I thought secure was gone and destroyed. And my bitterness ran deep, filled with hatred, venom, and thoughts of revenge. And I couldn't seem to move past it and get on with my life and living. And this Matthew 18 passage just added to my sense of guilt and shame. I was stuck. How could Jesus really expect me to forgive? Just accept, walk away from what had been taken from me? And why would I want to forgive when resentment and anger and bitterness felt so much more satisfying? I remember standing along the shoreline of a lake at sunset one time, marveling at the beauty and the wonder of creation before me, which turned into one of those amazing God moments. As I thought about my burning rage and sense of injustice, this Matthew 18 parable came to mind, and it spoke to me in a new way. as I thought about all the times that I had rejected God's will in ways, of all the people I'd hurt during my life, my sin and harm done, including needing to be forgiven for my refusing to forgive, and then how readily Jesus had loved and forgiven me at such a high and terrible cost on the cross. At that moment, I was overwhelmed by the incredible depth of that love. And I knew what Jesus did for me was way more than what was done to me. I was allowing bitterness and hatred to define me and my perspective, when actually I was a blessed and precious child of God, defined by the love, grace, mercy, and promises of God. Or as described in Colossians 3, one of God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. Those three words, chosen, holy, and beloved, help define and characterize and describe who each one of us are. The children of God's grace, forgiven to follow Jesus Christ. Chosen, meaning that the gracious love of God preceded any righteousness on our part, and that we didn't choose him, but the Lord chose each one of us. This is a strong sense of being favored and blessed, not earned or deserved, but simply chosen to be loved. And that we're defined by God's grace toward us. And in response, we are called to live as advertisements out in the world, declaring by how we live and relate to others God's love and healing, that it can change human lives. For knowing that we are loved and secure in this world leads to a different perspective than this world, especially how we treat others who are also, every one of them, loved by God. And holy, meaning that we have been set apart according to God's healing and redeeming purpose, called out from this world's corruption and darkness to live lives in reflecting God's light and compassion. And beloved, meaning that regardless of our past or present problems and failures, our God never gives up on us or stops loving us. There'll always be another second chance to receive grace afresh, to participate in the abundant life God intends for us by changing our response to things that happened in the past. Let me repeat that. By changing our response to things that happened in the past. Because we are God's own chosen, holy, and beloved, starting in verse 12, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Above all, clothe yourselves with love that binds everything together in perfect harmony. I'm reminded of watching someone get baptized when I was in Ghana. And afterward, they burned their old clothes and put on new clothes, symbolizing a fresh start and a new life in Jesus Christ. But it's not always easy to trust and live out that faithfully and fully. Sometimes we continue to fall back and wallow in our old ways because we have something that you might call a zombie problem. Our old self of sin and selfishness is still lurking around, still influencing our attitude, our behavior, and our perspective. Instead of living joyful, hope-filled lives transformed by the gracious love of God and the Holy Spirit at work within us, sometimes we slip back into our old, dead ways, taking up the values of this corrupt and broken world and living less than the blessed lives intended by our Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes we forget who we really are. Chosen, holy, beloved. And we forget the gracious gifts, promises, and hope, the blessings of God. And instead we take on the deadly corruptions of our culture, the flawed ways, the values, and ideas of this world. That is our ongoing walking dead zombie problem. That sometimes we fail to live the transformed and exceptional lives that truly proclaim the truth and gospel of Jesus Christ, and that faithfully reflect the grace, forgiveness, and mercy of our God. Our call and our hope is to remember what it means that God forgave us and keep that grace of Jesus Christ in the center of our hearts by seeking first an authentic relationship with Jesus Christ that leads to meaningful, faithful, and joyful discipleship, so that together we live lives that declare Jesus is our Lord. To forgive is not to condone or acquiesce to wrong or injustice, but it's our simple refusal to let it overwhelm and destroy us, or to alienate us away from God's love and away from one another. The choice is between living in the kingdom of God, the gracious forgiveness of Christ, or in the ways of this world, unforgiveness, bitterness, and hate. That is the issue at stake, especially today, as the election rhetoric gets more heated and the COVID-19 persists. All of that ugly that will surely destroy. So, what if starting right now, we as Christians refuse to participate or contribute in any way that adds to the polarizing hatred, rancor, and unforgiveness so prevalent in our world, in our culture, and on social media? And instead, seek to break the cycle of retribution and revenge with a new attitude of hope and gratitude and forgiveness toward life closer to God's heart and the kingdom of God. Instead of attack, we do grace. For as Jesus said in Matthew 6:33, but strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. And that is the promise and the word of our God. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you, Lord, for your endless grace, your limitless love, and that we are all your chosen, holy, and beloved children. Help us, Lord, to live out that truth more faithfully, to pause and let your Spirit speak and act through us. We pray this all through Jesus' name. Amen. Let us join in our closing hymn 445, God, How Can We Forgive? And now may the love and grace hold and sustain us. May the love and grace of God change and transform our lives and how we see this world. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.